We're from here. That's important to us.
We do have struggles.
The issues that divide us.
But this state is hurting in rural places.
To the solutions that bring us together.
We all tell the same jokes. We all have the same classes and the same problems.
I never thought I'd see all these mills redeveloped.
From Channel 8 WMTW, this is a Project Community Special Report. Here are your hosts, Tracy Sable, Steve Minnick, Megan Torgerson, and Steve Battari. This is the Two Maines.
The state of Maine, it's great for many reasons. The beauty, and of course, the people.
And anyone who lives here likely knows the phrase, the Two Maines. It's the idea that the state is divided by politics, geography, and the economy, almost like making it two different states.
But where exactly is that divide? Can you draw it on a map, or can it be found in the same city or town? The answer to both is yes.
Tonight we come to you from two different locations. In Portland, a place many consider an economic engine in the state.
And in Rumford, a town like so many others in Maine, where a mill is or used to be the heartbeat of the area.
Both areas are iconic Maine in their own ways, and both face a future of change.
Tonight, we examine the differences and highlight what unifies us as Mainers.
This is the Two Maines, a Project Community Special Report.
Now, the idea that there are two Maines really isn't anything new. In fact, there have been efforts in the legislature to split the state into North and South. And there were similar movements in other states. Some people wanted to split California into three states as recently as last year. New York could have been divided several ways. Some even wanted New York City to become the 51st state. And the most recent attempt to split Maine happened back in 2015. Now, we ask why this has started in the first place.
I believe that it has to do with opportunity, with resources, with timing.
Renowned Maine historian Herb Adams has traced the theory of two Maines back centuries to the rise of manufacturing. To find wealth, you just followed the waterways.
First Maine, you might say, that was beyond the settlement era had to do with water, specifically where it was and who controlled it and who could get there first and put their mill in first.
While in recent years some might claim the two Maines as the sparsely populated North versus the prosperous South, Adams says throughout most of Maine's history, any dividing line was better defined by economics rather than geography.
You know, the discussion has some ring of truth in it, but the division of the state doesn't. I've never noticed that poverty and need follows the compass needle.
This state is hurting in rural places.
Dick Barringer has studied the Two Maines theory extensively, even authored several books on the subject. In fact, Barringer is the man most credited with coining the phrase Two Maines. As the state's planning director in 1985, he delivered a poignant speech to the Bangor Rotary Club.
I said, I'm here today to deliver a difficult message that from an economic point of view, there are now two Maines in the state. And if we don't deal with it, it's only going to get worse.
At the time, Barringer based much of his assertion on the fact the international paper industry was rapidly turning its interest away from Maine, which he predicted could eventually have dire consequences. Applauded by some, many took offense.
It was seen as a moral judgment on rural Maine rather than as a piece of useful economic analysis.
Even Barringer never detailed any exact lines of delineation between his two Maines on the map. But at least one man has. As late as 2010, Representative Henry Joy of Aroostook County proposed legislation to literally create two separate states, the South and his North.
That place would be called Maine, and we could call the rest of Maine North Boston or whatever we chose, because that's what he felt we were becoming.
Though Joy's idea received little support, it has helped fuel the continued conversation over what so many see as a serious Maine divide.
If it weren't for Portland, Maine would be in a recession right now.
Finding the economic boat that will be floated by one thing that will help everybody is very hard to do. in a state as diverse as Maine, with so many different ecological regions and manufacturing regions.
Sometimes the two Maines aren't just divided by north and south,
but also a power line. As Mary Kate Mannion shows us, the argument over CMP's proposed corridor is playing out in several communities and is dividing neighbors in one small town.
Here's your view. This is where the corridor is going. Pretty well right over our heads.
Standing on the top of Johnson Mountain, Peter Dosti takes in the view. It's one he knows well. He's a rafter, snowmobiler, and the owner of the Hawk's Nest Lodge in West Forks.
The North Woods of Maine they're special. They're unbroken.
Peter's concern, the New England Clean Energy Connect, a high-voltage transmission line that would run from the Canadian border to Lewiston. It will parallel an existing line for 90 miles, but 53 new ones would pass around the south and west side of Johnson Mountain. It's the same view that Ed Buzzle prizes off of his back porch.
Pretty well destroyed my view. You're looking at 100-foot poles.
Just down the road is a piece of peace and quiet that brings visitors from all over the world.
It's a place you can get lost and unplug and discover. It really surprises me that...
Cliff Stevens has been running a campground and outdoor river adventure on the shores of Lake Moxie for 26 years. But things have changed in the last year.
It's not like a Hatfield and McCoy's type thing, you know. We still all work together. But it has, you've seen shifts in where people do business.
The Forks and West Forks is a small community. News travels fast here.
And here's one of our...
But Cliff said he was blindsided when fellow rafting companies didn't mention the project to him.
You'd be in their establishments having dinner and never say a word.
Along with the camp is a river rafting business, a 12-mile run through rapids on the Kennebec River that he says will be cut in half by the power line.
When they come down that river at 6 miles, they're going to see that tower and they're going to go, or they're going to see evidence of a tower or the cooling towers, and they're going to start thinking about getting out, getting on the phone, checking their internet, checking the emails and stuff.
Central Maine Power disagrees, though, and says that no infrastructure will be visible from the river.
You won't see the project at all. And in addition, we've made other changes to minimize the visual impacts.
Thorne Dickinson says that burying the line at the Kennebec Gorge is just one example of listening to communities. In his mind, this line will tackle a real challenge facing the state and the North Woods.
The real risk for Northern Maine Woods is climate change. I mean, that's the real risk for that region.
Dickinson says there are incentives for Mainers that range from $50 million to help those with low incomes with their energy costs to bringing broadband to certain communities, with the project aiming to go live in 2022.
They're going to receive cleaner air. They're going to also have new investments in nature-based tourism.
Those benefits earning support from the Maine State Chamber of Commerce.
This project also brought with it employment. It brought with it taxes. It brought with it broadband by virtue of the package.
Well, the NECEC is roughly going to go up about this way.
Recreational improvements like snowmobile trails that excite Bob Myers. He oversees the Maine Snowmobilers Association, and on this large map in their Augusta office, he traces his idea of two Maines.
It really is the Volvo line, which is Route 2, that kind of cuts across the central part of the state, east to west.
CMP has guaranteed access to snowmobiles for the entire access of the NECEC line, and the association gave their support. In fact, Bob was a bit surprised by what he calls controversy.
It bothers us, this notion of people that think that they somehow have a right to tell other people what they can do with their property.
And while some in the association voice disapproval, Bob notes their membership remains fairly much the same.
People were claiming that hundreds of our members would quit and all this. It never happened.
In his years running the program, Bob says he's heard his fair share of complaints, like a rough trail or two.
I have never, ever had a single person say, my experience was ruined because I saw a power line, or I saw a bridge or a smokestack from a paper mill or something. You know, it's part of the package.
And the package is all of Maine, from the coast to the woods, according to Bob.
The activity that happens down here helps what's going on up here with the banks. I mean, it's one big state. And, you know, obviously there's very different types of businesses and industries and everything, but it's all going in the same pot.
It's all one Maine.
It's all one Maine.
Sometimes the two Maines can be found in the same place.
In the same harbor, Portland is vital to maintaining Maine's seafood industry, but at the same time, it is a gold mine for developers looking to build on the waterfront.
Joe Glauber takes a look at both sides of the argument. Fishermen say maintaining Portland's working waterfront is key to sustaining the multi-million dollar seafood industry that brings so many visitors to Maine's coast each year.
How big it is or how far it goes, people can debate on what's good and what isn't.
Steve Train has launched from this spot on the Portland Pier on and off for the last three decades, and he's seen the cycle. Maine's fishermen are tasked with sustaining the multi-million dollar seafood industry. Last year, they harvested $637 million worth of seafood from the ocean. The coastline, the water, and the seafood they find within helps draw millions of tourists to Portland each year. Businesses expand to take advantage, and some fishermen have started to feel squeezed out.
We do have struggles in some places on the waterfront with access issues and parking issues. And I think a lot of that is why this whole waterfront zoning thing came up.
Steve was part of a working group put together to tackle this pivotal issue. How much should be developed and how much should be reserved for marine-related uses?
You take a place like this where they kept our tank room, improved our berth, and guaranteed us parking. To me, that's a good use of working waterfront.
Portland City Council eventually decided this summer to reduce what's called the non-marine use overlay zone, the area between Commercial Street and the working fishing piers where non-marine development is allowed. It shrunk that zone by 25 feet, but gave the owners of those wharves options when it came to mixed use.
It does allow the wharf owners to get more profit out of their property, and that will help us.
And that was a big change.
Union Wharf has been owned by Charlie Poole's family for at least six generations. They had just completed a building on their 6 acres of waterfront land, but other wharves, he says, could be more affected by the changes. He says while fishermen need space, wharf owners need ways to bring in money that will pay for costly upgrades when the time comes.
What's the balance between where are you generating the revenue to take care of the property and at the same time not taking anything away?
That's where organizations like the Maine Coast Fishermen's Association are working to help find solutions. Monique Coombs is among those working to share concerns of fishermen all across Maine, getting to know them on a personal level, along with the communities that rely on them.
The working waterfront does not just mean one wharf in one specific place. It extends beyond the wharf to the community, the culture.
While she says that remains true in fishing communities all along the coast, the problems...
We are not like Portland. Portland has a totally different issues than we have.
...can look a little different.
If you want to change the way it is around here, you'd probably pick the bad place to come.
Terry Alexander is a co-partner of his wharf in Cundy's Harbor.
You got to kind of adapt in the fishing game. You know, you can't be sitting around waiting for the fish to come.
He knows the perils of the fishing industry all too well, but he says the congestion problem is not the same on the mid-coast. No matter where you go along the coast, he says access is key. Otherwise, its coastal beauty is likely to attract a more wealthy suitor.
I don't know what the hell this place is worth, but I'm sure it's worth a lot of money, but it'll never be worth any money to any of us because we all want our kids to have access to this.
But he says the state has helped new entrants into the fishery, and its Working Waterfront Access Protection Program decided to infuse six communities with more than $1 million total, buying development rights to guarantee working access for fishermen.
This is such an isolating occupation. There are so many uncertainties. It's all out of pocket.
And advocates like Monique say that they're trying to study some of what's only been anecdotal in the past. They're hoping to go beyond the busy season and help Maine's fishermen year-round.
But it's like, okay, how do we have that and be cognizant of the other 10 months of the year in Maine where we don't have the same type of tourism?
Challenges for fishermen, from bait prices to weather and regulation, are always there. But most agree it's a never-ending process.
We don't need special favors. What we need is zoning that protects us.
When you buy some clothing, it doesn't fit you forever. The same with zoning.
And when it comes to balancing the industry with non-marine development, they say working together will be better than going it alone.
For generations to come, Portland will maintain its working waterfront.
They need what they need. So finding that compromise and reaching that sweet spot that keeps us here, keeps the wharfs in good shape, and allows them to make money on their wharf, I think that's, you know, that's how we get things done. That's how we work together.
It's no secret that living in parts of southern Maine is expensive.
Coming up, we examine the industries that are being affected as Mainers are being priced out of the area.
And jumping online in some areas, it's not an easy task.
We'll show you how one Mainer is addressing the problem of lack of broadband and how it's so vital, even on the farm.
This is the Two Maines. We'll be right back.
And when I was a kid, you'd hear these old characters talking, and it would sound like this. Oh, God, there's something going on there. Oh, what's there? You couldn't even get a word. You know, what are they saying?
When it comes to Two Maines, it's hard to find something more noticeable than the cost of living. The spike has been dramatic in Portland, but less extreme in other southern Maine communities.
That difference, really just the span of a few dozen miles, has been putting the spotlight on income inequality as people look to buy local real estate.
Low inventory, more buyers, interest rates are low. What do you have? You have a lot of competition.
The competition is putting intense pressure on those with a limited budget. Low and middle income earners looking to spend between $200,000 and $300,000 are getting priced out due to demand.
Harder on buyers, especially if they're $300,000 or under. That's a really challenging price point to get into.
Portland's hospitality and service industry is one of the hardest hit sectors. Restaurant, bar, and hotel workers are tough to find and keep. That's because they can't find affordable housing. Forget buying a home. Many are struggling just to afford rent during peak season.
We're going to have to figure out a solution to the seasonality housing issue. Part of it is having better transportation to bring people in from areas that maybe here in the peninsula where we are today, you know, housing is very expensive. But not so much as you get a little bit off the peninsula.
About 30 miles south in Kennebunkport, location is also a priority, but for a very different reason. The build package on this vacant oceanfront lot came out to $4.5 million. The people eyeing these properties are often from out of state.
We're looking at buyers that have sold their home in a great market. Now they can come up to Maine and say, I'm going to live here full time.
That out-of-state money is putting even more of a pinch on the local market. Some buyers just can't compete with the offers coming from away.
They want to get out of the city. They want mountains, ocean, and that quality of life that we offer here in Maine.
From our perspective as a native Mainer, it seems like, wow, we've had such expansion in pricing, which we have. But it doesn't seem as bad for some of the people that come in from other places.
Your money will go further the further you go from downtown hotspots. Properties in rural York County are selling for far less than closer to the turnpike, at the expense of convenience. There's also the fixer-upper factor that realtors say many people are shying away from. If you're willing to do work on a home, you'll get it for a lot less.
If the property is in move-in condition, those are always the ones that are going to sell faster. Otherwise, you're going to take a real hit on pricing because buyers... A lot of buyers don't, they don't want to do that project.
Coming up later in the show, Tyler shows us how some of the old mills are being brought back to life in the form of new housing and employment options.
Here in southern Maine, it's easy to take for granted access to high-speed internet.
But for those who live in rural parts of the state, access to broadband can be challenging.
Kathleen Jordan introduces us to a farmer in Penobscot County who uses some Maine innovation to get on the information highway.
When it comes to getting access to broadband internet, it's not a tale of this Maine compared to this Maine.
The thought that, oh, there's a bigger population here, you're good, is not necessarily true.
There's actually a tale of two Maines within every county.
It's not a luxury.
In Penobscot County, Dan Kaplan may be a new farmer.
You know, right away I realized we have a problem here.
Just kind of start with an ice pack on the bottom.
But he's not new to business. He gave up four decades of marketing and media in cities across the country to follow his dream.
I always wanted to do farming. I wanted to do farming since I was a kid.
Landing here on 300 acres of land in Charleston, Maine.
5 pounds of our ground beef.
But he almost didn't make it.
I tried satellite. I tried DSL.
He didn't have access to high-speed internet on his farm, so he couldn't sell his 100% grass-fed beef online.
We're all used to what I would call an Amazon experience, right? You order it, it's shipped to you, you're told where it is and when it's going to arrive. And to be successful these days as a business, you've got to at least equal that.
About a year ago, Kaplan found a workaround. He put an antenna in the highest tree on his farm, bringing him a connection and big business. But for most, it's not that easy. Antennas only work if there's a clear line of sight to another. When Kaplan asked about installing a fiber optic wire on his road,
I said, well, what will that cost? And he said, $18,000.
If you have many homes on that mile, it's a lot cheaper to run it. If you don't have many homes on that mile, it's a lot more expensive.
Peggy Schaefer is the director of Connect Me, an initiative working to fill the gap for rural communities through state funds.
We have about 80,000, 83,000 people in Maine that are unserved, which is essentially the total population of Franklin and Oxford County combined.
But she says that number is actually higher because the FCC considers a census block served even if only one home has access to the internet. She also says this is a problem in every county.
The thought that Cumberland County is all set is not true.
Taking a deeper look into the state's most populated county, where some still aren't connected, a recent survey commissioned by Cumberland County found even customers with internet access aren't happy with their connection. So much so that 87% of the 775 people interviewed supported a community-led, bond-funded effort to bring better service.
New data shows that rural economies can grow tremendously once they are connected, and if they're not connected, they get left behind, which is the real scary part.
Going to Westwood, Massachusetts. And
beyond giving businesses like Kaplan's a boost, Schaefer says broadband helps Maine's aging population age in place.
It brings opportunities around telehealth, so you don't have to drive a long way to go see your doctor. It brings huge opportunities around educational attainment, not just for the kids in school, but for workers who want to get back into school. They can take classes online.
Planning and infrastructure grants, Connect Me helps communities attract providers and then pay for the service, which is more than just a connection. The equipment itself is expensive. And for people who have never had internet access, they need to learn how to use it.
How do you maximize a search engine for a small business? Telehealth, the patients have to get used to talking to their doctor.
Connect Me is getting up to $2 million in funding this next fiscal year. Money that will help those who can't find a workaround, like Kaplan.
There's a demand for our products, but the only way to reach it is really digitally and to kind of knock down the geographic barriers.
It was unplanned and unprecedented.
The refugee surge in Lewiston 20 years ago. Coming up, the lessons learned and how that's helping a new group of Mainers going through similar challenges. The surge of asylum seekers in Portland over the summer was unplanned for and unprecedented for the city.
But another Maine city went through a surge of its own nearly 20 years ago. This is a look at that experience and the lessons learned in Lewiston.
Sun is shining, it's a fresh snow, and I'm like, this place, it only has wood and tree and no human beings.
Fatuma Hussein still remembers the moment she first laid eyes on Lewiston.
It's got a lot of emotions packed into that whole thing.
It was during that first trip.
We really loved Lewiston.
She decided that would be home. So did lots of other refugees who, starting in 2001, mainly just by word of mouth, started arriving by the hundreds.
Lewiston, unlike Portland, was not a refugee resettlement city.
In fact, Lewiston's former deputy administrator, Phil Netto, tells us what happened there has never been documented anywhere else. Refugees already officially resettled in other parts of the U.S., just unofficially deciding to move to Lewiston en masse.
These unplanned, unprogrammed relocations, people just getting up and moving on their own and coming into Lewiston, which is very hard to plan for.
Nevertheless, Netto, who's now retired and lives in Florida, was in charge of figuring out a plan for the city, which now has more than 7,500 immigrants, making up almost 20% of the population.
What Portland can do is what Lewiston did, which was bring all of the folks on the ground together, working together.
But it wasn't without challenges.
It was change. You know, we were not only black people, but we were black people. We were Muslims. 9/11 just happened. So there were so many things that were working against us.
Go back home!
You are not doing nothing wrong!
When the story made national news, white supremacists came to Lewiston to protest. At one point, a pig's head was even thrown into a mosque. But over time, and with lots of work, officials say there are clear signs things have improved. Many point to the high school soccer team's state championship win a few years ago as a sign of the progress made.
Here in Lewiston, officials say like when the Irish and other immigrant groups first arrived here in the city, there's a recognition of the challenges that won't simply disappear overnight.
We still have a lot of work to do when it comes to race relations and xenophobia and all the things that go with that.
And there are still flashpoints, like clashes in Kennedy Park.
It's quite a bit of fear around people who look like us, who worship like us. No matter what we do, we're not good enough. No matter what we do, we're not American enough.
The focus in Lewiston is now on erasing those fears and building on 20 years of work in a place that's now been home for Fatuma for two decades.
It feels home. I keep telling, I used to say in 2001, whether you like it or not, we're here to stay. So the sooner you get used to us, the sooner we'll all get along. And, you know, suck it up, you know, just what? We're here. We're Americans just like you.
A way of life at risk.
How the state's $1 billion logging industry could be in jeopardy if Maine doesn't improve its roads.
You're watching The Two Maines, a Project Community special report from Channel 8 WMTW.
Welcome back. Tonight we are examining what makes up the two Maines.
The differences in politics, economics, and everything else.
We'll show you what communities are doing to bridge those divides.
These stories have taken the better part of a year to put together, and we bring them to you right now. Once considered the driving force of the state's economy, the mill industry is now largely associated with the years gone by.
All of the mills in southern Maine closed decades ago.
And many farther to the north have struggled to make a profit and eventually called it quits. But as Tyler Catterett tells us, some communities are bucking that trend and keeping the machines rolling. Others are reviving the old buildings and capitalizing on the space in different ways.
It's the history of the building that's so, you know, if the walls could talk, what would they tell us?
There would no doubt be plenty of stories dating back to the mid-1800s. Carol McAllister's apartment is one of 150 inside this Saco Mill building that was once a shoe factory.
There used to be quite a few other mill buildings on the island, but those have since been torn down, so we're lucky this one's still standing and we've been able to redevelop it.
It's one of a bunch of mills along the river in Saco and Biddeford that have been transformed from abandoned eyesores to thriving hotspots in the past decade.
Pretty popular spot, I would imagine, for both people looking to rent and also businesses looking to set up shop.
Yeah, we actually have quite a few folks that in the building live here and work here as well.
Matt Dubois, now in charge of this space, remembers a time not so long ago when snow blew in through boarded windows and no one imagined the words booming and mill in the same sentence.
I grew up in Biddeford and I never thought I'd see all these mills redeveloped with businesses and people living inside them.
While many of the mill buildings here in southern Maine have pumped new life into their downtown communities as the hot places to eat, shop, and live, further north, it looks a bit different. Here in Rumford, you won't find bar stools or bedrooms inside the paper mill. It's still the manufacturing hub here in town, supporting the economy in a more traditional way.
Well, this is probably one of the most flexible and versatile mills anywhere in Maine and probably anywhere in northeastern New England.
The mill, bought by Nine Dragons Paper out of Hong Kong a few years back, has been a fixture in town for generations.
At the height of mill employment, 6,000 men went to work every day there.
Those numbers are a thing of the past, but against the odds, the mill itself isn't. The initial idea to put it here forever changed this region.
Crawford's got a unique history. That decision by, you know, people long gone, that decision to locate a mill here triggered a lot of things that, you know, continue this day.
The same is true in York County, where Carol's art hangs on bricks laid over 100 years ago. She compares it to living in a museum.
I feel like I'm still on vacation, except when I clean, then I know I live here. But I just think I am so lucky that I live here.
Where some live, others work. Perhaps the most unique aspect of mill redevelopment is the shift in how business is conducted inside. Instead of one large factory, a community of individual businesses drive the local economy now. They've set up shop under the same wooden beams that used to run above the assembly lines. It's a different sense of community in Rumford. Peter Chase has lived here his entire life.
Is it a point of pride for people around here that it still is operational like it is?
I think it is, and I think maybe that's one of the reasons why they decided to buy this mill, because of the pride that's in the papermakers.
The future looked quite bleak for business about a decade ago, but the new ownership and a steady supply of quality timber and clean water in the area has kept the paper operation going.
The people in the community are resilient. The people in the community are optimistic, and it's certainly it's fascinating to both be part of and to see unfold.
The mill's continued success not only means jobs for pulp and paper workers, but others nearby too. Rumford's business district, referred to as the Island, has storefronts, banks, and restaurants, all doing well in a relatively small economy. Tourism is on the up and up too, with plans to open a new hotel in town sometime next year.
We've gone from a paper mill town to a town that still has a paper mill.
Mill redevelopment in Rumford is even happening today. One piece of the mill's property now serves as a tech center.
Driving across Maine, you can see the roads are pretty rough, and that's impacting our $1 billion logging industry. David Charnes asks what it will take to fix Maine's roads.
The road surface is not flat. The road surface is either crowned like this or actually in your own lane, some cases, it's crowned.
These roads matter a lot to Stephen Hannington.
A lot of miles a year.
Miles mean money. Every minute on the road fuels his business.
Roads have an impact on the driver, but the bigger cost to this is the whole rural economy.
An economy that relies on people getting to and from here in Mohawk, Maine. Population 79. Hannington employs many of his neighbors hauling timber from stump to mill. He blames rutting and crowning for damaging his trucks and his way of life.
These aren't designed to go.
Parts that should last 8 to 10 years are lasting 3.
What they're doing is they wait till the pavement goes, then they pave, and then they pave. They need to be rebuilt.
The average Maine contractor will spend 150 miles per round trip out on the road, the majority on the secondary roads like Route 116 in Chester. It all fuels $1 billion of Maine's economy.
It's so bad, some drivers are choosing to work for companies that avoid these roads and take I-95 instead. But the highway doesn't go everywhere, and sometimes these state routes are the only option.
These roads need to be rebuilt. You need to be taking a section of miles, tearing them up, changing the base.
You've got a crown and you have virtually no shoulder.
Dana Doran is the executive director of the Professional Logging Contractors of Maine. He says these tight roads, the arteries of an economy employing 2,500 people, are old, worn out, and forgotten.
You know, you've got to cut costs, and if your costs are going up because of whether it's maintenance or the inability to move products, you're going to have to cut jobs. That's the bottom line. We're not casting blame on anyone. I think what we need to do is come up with that solution, and part of that is funding.
Now there's a new blue ribbon committee tasked with finding that funding. State Senator Bill Diamond is a co-chair.
But we need to find a number of options that the commission can look at and say, you know what, this is, all these together make a fair approach.
But it's costly. Redoing 1 mile of road from top to bottom, 1 mile, can cost $3 to $5 million. Just for projects next year, Maine DOT needs more than $100 million in bonds and matching federal funds. Ideas include raising the gas tax. Raising it by just a penny, 1 cent, will bring an additional $7 million in every year. But that is not enough.
That's a lot of pennies to get up to $160 million. We can't do that.
Simply put, we need more money and new roads. Without that, Hannington worries his business, these jobs, and his way of life will be gone.
What's wrong with rural life? I think people are going to enjoy rural life if they have a job, but you can't have a job without roads and bridges.
And until something is done, time will just make these roads even worse.
Maine's worker shortage stretches across industries and jobs. It's a combination of factors, including a high retirement rate and the lack of skilled workers. But a new group of Mainers, immigrants, asylum seekers, and refugees, many of them highly skilled, there's just one big obstacle in their way. It's the language barrier. But tonight, we show you the program trying to change that.
It's in this room, filled with computers and a map of the world on the wall, where new Mainers from all parts of the globe work to start a new life in a new country, in a new language.
Most immigrants, when they come here, they hit that language barrier. They become depressed and they just give up.
The staff at the Greater Portland Immigrant Welcome Center says getting past that language barrier includes connecting their English lessons to the real world, specifically their workplace.
Located. It will tell me you did a listen to the word again. Make sure you stress the correct syllable.
Here, the online instruction includes tailored business jargon and medical terms that one wouldn't come across in typical language classes, but are vital to success in certain jobs.
There's an opportunity to move on in the work that they're working in and not stay stuck in one job forever.
Yeah. And language is the key to that?
Language is the key.
In fact, they say this online platform can cut the time to language acquisition in half. And most important, they say, it can open career doors.
We are immigrants. We know the one size fits all in the classroom. Most people come already with educational background. They need to be integrated in a job. So learning general English would take too long.
The executive director of the Welcome Center says he understands firsthand the frustration of highly skilled immigrant workers limited by their language.
When I came, I was proficient in English.
Yeah.
And over time, I see people who I know who have even higher degrees than I had, who are doing jobs that don't match their skills.
His group is now partnering with major employers like Maine Health to provide language lessons at the workplace, fulfilling what he says is a growing gap in Maine's economy.
You see, Maine has a population problem, an aging workforce, and near stagnant population growth. Advocates say the solution for Maine's economy is immigration.
The business community has really had a wake-up call and said, oh my gosh, we need these people.
Beth Stickney of the Maine Business Immigration Coalition says immigrants accounted for almost all of our net population gains since 2010.
The immigrants who are coming here also have, as a rule, higher educations than we have, which again becomes a frustrating thing for them when they're working on a factory floor, when they could be doing IT, they could be doing accounting, they could be being a doctor.
In Augusta, MEBIC is pushing legislation that would help more companies to offer those tailored language classes, while the Welcome Center is now expanding where it offers the programs.
There's a lot of happening around the country, around immigration. Most of them are very sad, but locally we can build successful stories together. Immigrant laws are federal. Immigrant integration is about a community where we are.
The two Maines can be separated by just a few miles.
Two schools with not a lot in common show that they can bridge a divide with just an open mind. We'll show you the groundbreaking program when we come back. When it comes to diversity, the idea of two Maines spans just one county line in central Maine.
There's Lewiston High School, one of the most diverse in the state, in one of the state's biggest cities. Then there's Marinacook, small, rural, and lacking in diversity.
But while the two schools may seem very different, the students have found common ground thanks to one groundbreaking program.
Once again, here's Tyler Catterat.
You're one of the smartest and kindest people I know.
When Operation Breaking Stereotypes started between Lewiston and Marinacook 4 years ago, the students involved had no idea what they were getting into.
The only things I had heard about Lewiston were like bad things.
Lewiston kids were convinced that Marinacook kids would be really racist and would say, you know, racist slurs to them.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
It's misconceptions like those that drive this program. Today, most of the students are getting ready to graduate. We met them as they gathered as a group one last time.
I mean, they're amazing kids. I mean, they've grown immensely in just those 4 years, starting out as freshmen.
The two high schools are in the same area, but the similarities end there. Marinacook is a small, rural school and almost entirely white. Lewiston has a much more diverse student population, including many new Mainers.
As a child of an immigrant, it's hard for me to adjust to like this foreign land. I'm very new. Like, I didn't know how to greet people. I didn't know how to kind of adjust to like the culture here.
Each student was assigned a partner from the other school. Over the years, the pairs have shared stories, visited one another's homes, and talked a lot about diversity and acceptance.
But I feel like if people like us like continue to do what we do, it can change.
Turns out they have a lot more in common than they thought at first.
We all tell the same jokes. We all have the same classes and the same problems, like, day to day.
The bonds and connections formed through this program extend well beyond the program itself. Many of the students who otherwise wouldn't have crossed paths now consider themselves close friends.
And they even came to one of my lacrosse games sophomore year at Lewiston, and they came and supported me.
Man, that second year, it was incredible. I mean, I remember at the end of the year, Connie, Peter, and I looked at each other after we met at Thomas, and we're just like, that felt like one big family.
The students also recognize it's a special connection.
At the end of the day, it's a fun little get-together, and you grow together as a family.
Sam and RJ are both going to UMaine Orono in the fall. They plan to stay close into college and beyond.
This program has been like a really great tool for me to like make friends and like kind of discover like the culture that's here that's different from what I grew up in.
And thank you for being my partner.
For those involved, that's the true measure of success.
I think one student said, I feel closer to my partner than I feel to a lot of my friends back at my school.
Operation Breaking Stereotypes continues at both schools this year with a new group of students.
Program leaders spent the first few weeks of the new school year finding interested students. And just this month, they are getting started.
From first generation to a deep-rooted family history.
Or maybe a little something in between. We have a little fun about what makes a Mainer when we come back.
What makes a true Mainer, do you think?
I don't know. I think you have to be born in Maine to be a true one.
How do you say park the car?
Park the car. Yeah.
So here's a question. What does it take to qualify as a real Mainer?
Some say you need to be born here. Others say if you live and work here, that's just fine.
Jim Keithley set out to ask people that very question.
The quintessential fishing village of Cundy's Harbor just might be the perfect place to find out what makes a genuine, bona fide Mainer.
How long have you lived here in Cundy's Harbor?
80 years.
80 years, so you're a true Mainer.
That's right, yeah.
What makes a true Mainer, do you think?
I don't know. I think you have to be born in Maine to be a true one.
Yeah, my husband, Tom Watson.
At Watson's General Store, Darlene Watson is a fifth generation Mainer.
We've been here since 1852, and my son is the sixth generation, TJ, yeah. And he's got a little baby coming in December, so he'll be the seventh.
At Watson's, you can get everything from a bucket of paint to a slice of pizza.
Just quiet, you know, serene. I love it. I wouldn't want to live anywhere else but Maine.
Why would she? Look at the view from her office, where it's still cash only, no computers, and paper receipts. Down on the docks, Todd Wallace, a lobsterman for most of his life. Captain Zach is his office, and he answers to no one as he hauls in the day's catch, Maine's most popular delicacy.
Are you a true Mainer?
I believe so, yeah. I've been a few different places, and I couldn't wait to get back home.
So what really makes a Mainer? Well, to start, you have to own at least one sweater from L.L. Bean and a pair of their famous boots. What do you think makes a real Mainer, aside from being born here?
Oh, I think the values, people, the way people are, they help each other out, they
are there for their neighbors. They're hard workers. Good qualities, good people.
Maybe when trying to find out what makes a true Mainer, you ask someone from away.
You're just different up here. You don't get bent out of shape about things that we do in Louisiana. And you don't really care about people's business. In the South, you know, everybody wants to know about everything else and they'll ask all kinds of questions.
Maine humorist Tim Sample zooms through life, earning his living. Entertaining audiences by telling jokes about everything Maine and the way life should be.
People say, what is this big thing about being from Maine? And I have a theory about that from living here my entire life, being born here, raised here, and dealing with this issue my whole life. People in Maine have huge pride of place. We're from here. That's important to us. It's our birthright.
The Martha Stewarts, the John Travoltas, and the Rockefellers might have all the money in the world, homes in Maine, but they're not Mainers, never will be. For the real answer, we revisit Maine historian Herb Adams.
You know, you can have nice people from away, as we say. Now, George Mitchell was born here. General Knox was not, but they were both fine people. Governor William King was born here. Governor Angus King was not, but they worked out okay.
And as I savor my wicked good whoopie pie, it hits me. As a real Mainer myself, I say, hey, yeah, I think that's about right.
Wicked.
No matter what divides us, the state of Maine is our beautiful home.
It's the people who are willing to come together that makes our state so great.
Our job here at Channel 8 WMTW is to tell your stories and hopefully start a discussion.
And we'll continue to tell your stories, and we hope you keep watching. Good night.
Rolling.
Okay, I'm rolling.
I need to talk as though there's another line.
I'll pretend like, you know
what
I'm saying?
Yes, I'm gonna look at you just like very
just side eye.
Yeah, I'm just gonna be like.
Although I messed up because I should have said that last line. It's that drone.
As Tyler Catterett tells us, a few committee.
What's his motivation?
It blew me over.
I just want to do it. Let's go. Oh, it's a butterfly.
Okay.
Butterfly. And I forgot what I was going to say. I'm sorry.
And are capitalizing on them. I couldn't find it.
Try this.
I'm with stupid. I'm just like talking. Go.
Did
you get a bug in your mouth?
Bug in mouth.
I'm good with it.
How's your guys feel?
Great.
Yeah, cool. Fine. I like that one.
And if we don't quit there and just go home.